Thank you very much, Sue. I am really delighted to be with you this morning, even though following John Nance on any stage is a really daunting challenge. I thought after listening to John that all I would have to do is come up and say what he said. But Sue would have been very unhappy, and as Jim pointed out earlier, we all work for Sue, even those of us who don't work at Medline. So I'm not going to do that. But I think what you'll see from my talk is that virtually every theme that John touched on will come back to you in slightly different ways, perhaps, and maybe, and certainly with some different words and different examples. But every principle that he articulated is part of the message that I want to leave you with this morning. And to start with, I grew up in New York and was fortunate to be able to study philosophy at a very young age because I was a Yankee fan, and still am, actually. Thank you. Please, that's perfectly appropriate, except for you Mets fans. That's all right. Mets can inhabit New York, too. And we were very fortunate because we had Casey Stengel, and we had Yogi Berra. And if you listened really carefully to what they said, you didn't really need much more in terms of philosophy. And one of the principles of Yogi's that I have always taken to heart is that if you don't know where you're going, chances are you'll end up somewhere else. Think about that. So as we talk about what we need to do in order to make healthcare better for our patients and for the people that work with us when we try to deliver healthcare, it's very important, I think, to have a pretty clear picture of where we want to end up. And so just to put some put a stake in the ground, last year we worked with our board at the Joint Commission to create that kind of a vision statement. What would healthcare be like if we were all wildly successful at all of our efforts to improve safety and quality and the working environment that we all want to be joyful, as John suggested? And it might look something like this. All people always experience the safest, highest quality, best value healthcare across all settings. And this is a vision that the Joint Commission created specifically for ourselves, first of all, as a place that all of our activities and programs across all three components of the Joint Commission, I'll come back to that a little later, all of those activities should align, whether they're accreditation activities, performance measurement, the Sentinel Event Program, the education consulting that JCR does, the international programs, or the activities of our new Center for Transforming Healthcare, all should be aligned to help us move in the direction of that vision. And when health reform passed, we thought it would be very helpful to us to look at the health reform law and all of the requirements that we're all struggling to understand, and as those regulations roll out, we will have a lot more work to do to understand. And if you look at the basics of that health reform law through this prism, I think you see some interesting things. First of all people. Lots more coverage. 32 million more people being covered in these new programs. Now, how long will it take for that to happen? What all of the details of it are important, but the basic goal here is to get closer to that all people part of the vision. Highest quality. Well, there's a lot of stuff in there about quality. It's really quite remarkable if you start trying to understand all of the intention, value-based purchasing, the CMS Innovation Center, the National QI strategy, a national strategy for quality improvement. That is quite a remarkable goal if it actually happens. The new institute, which is private, non-governmental, for comparative effectiveness research. Best value, lots of stuff in there about best value, about both increasing the numerator, the benefit of the value equation in terms of improved health, and reducing the denominator, the cost that it takes us to get there, accountable care organizations, bundled payment, value-based purchasing. Some of these ideas are meant to achieve more than one goal, right? And all settings. If there's one theme that you can tease out throughout the health reform law, it is coordination, reducing fragmentation, putting more responsibility for the entire patient experience from start to finish, whatever that means, into a single set of hands with payment and quality incentives aligned. Now, those are very big goals, and the devil is often in the details. But the opportunity here, as John said as well, there is risk, but there's also opportunity. The opportunity for those who get it right first is enormous. And I will come back to that in a couple of minutes. Now, all of that is the brand new stuff, right? It's not like we solved all the other stuff we were working on. And in fact, I completely agree with John's perspective, certainly from where I sit. Public stakeholders are demanding a level of excellence from the healthcare delivery system that they have never done before. And I mean by public stakeholders very broadly, anybody who is elected to government, anybody who serves in an executive capacity in government, but it's also the private sector, employers, insurers, and all of the folks that they represent. Those stakeholders are now not any longer buying what we used to be able to use in our smoke and mirrors. Yeah, there's some quality problems, but you know, they're across the river, they're down the road, they're not here. We hire the best doctors, the best nurses, we have the best healthcare, you know that. You pay us a lot of money, you must believe that. They're not buying that anymore. And our chronic problems are one of the reasons they're not buying it. We still have so much harm from preventable healthcare-associated infection, medication errors that cause harm, the lack of communication that leads to poor follow-up and missed opportunities to prevent deterioration, all of the struggles that you work with every day. And that's not enough. We have new problems that jump up and surprise us, that surprise us at the Joint Commission and surprise you as well, whether it's excess dosing from radiation therapy machines or excess dosing in CT scanning devices, other imaging devices, instrument reprocessing problems showing up in so many different ways almost every day. We are not solving these problems. And on top of the new demands from health reform, we've got to solve these problems as well. If you haven't seen this website, Dead by Mistake, I suggest that you take a look at it. It's one example of this public outcry for higher safety and quality. It is a the Hearst newspaper chain has maintained this now for a few years. And what you'll see on this website are heart-rending stories, usually told by survivors or family members of patients who the stories claim were injured by very preventable, very nasty mistakes that led to harm. And you listen to the stories, you read about them, and you sort of say, well, you know, that one probably wasn't really an error that should have been blown up like this. But you know what? It doesn't matter. These stories are everywhere. And they are leading to the increased heat on all of us. And I put the Joint Commission in with you as part of the delivery system because it's our job to help you get better and to help you solve these problems. The heat is, I agree here again with John, the heat is rising. So I think, put all that together in a brief overview of the quality safety context, I think the message from the health reform law, from public stakeholders, from where we are today with safety and quality, the message is very clear. Solve the problems. We don't want to hear any more about the effort and how much time and effort you're devoting to this. Just solve them. Show me the results. And by the way, get 30 more million people into your organizations and take care of them safely. Become or participate in an accountable care organization. That's where the puck will be. That's where the money will be. You have to figure that out. Oh, figure out bundled payments, too, because they're going to be coming along. And you better get those electronic health records adopted pretty quickly. And one more thing. You can't have any more money. Now, that's not just a tagline, actually. If you look at the way this health reform law is structured, from a big overview standpoint, the coverage increases are built into the structure of this law over the next several years. And unless some real earthquake happens, a Washington earthquake, not a Seattle one, and something gets repealed, those are inevitable. The costs that come along with those to the federal government, forget just about the private side for a moment, the costs are built in to those coverage increases. experiments with some of these new ideas, accountable care organizations, value-based purchasing, all of that, are ideas that nobody has any clear notion for how much cost it will save, if any. The true cost containment measures in this law are very few. There's really only one vehicle for saving money, and it is cutting payments to you and other providers, federal payments in the Medicare law, because that's what this law is based on, balancing federal outlays and federal revenue, not private sector, not total costs. It is crystal clear, and the accountants have a very good measure of how much federal costs will go up because of the coverage increases. The pressures from the federal deficit, which you are already familiar with, reading about, preventing all kinds of other steps that many economists say would help us get out of this recession quickly, the pressures from the federal deficit will require that if the experimental delivery forms do not deliver the cost savings that are necessary to get to the federal deficit to a balanced position, that not only will those $500 billion in Medicare cuts take place, that's a baseline, that is going to happen over the next 10 years, they will have to cut more. So, as my friend Rich Umdenstock at the American Hospital Association is fond of saying to all healthcare organizations, especially hospitals, you will never be paid better than you are today. That was true 6 months ago and a year ago, and it will be true tomorrow and next week. So the time is not going to get better 6 months from now to start thinking about how to get ready for this new stuff. The time is now. So the basic challenge to us, all of us as a society, and to individual healthcare organizations that healthcare reform and this quality context poses, it seems to me, is how do we get control of our costs in order to avoid the major, if you think the payment cuts have been big so far, really you ain't seen nothing yet, to avoid major payment cuts or, equally bad, big benefit reductions or what everybody has been afraid of but has not really taken place and would probably be a last resort, but federal deficits have a way of producing last resorts in Washington. Real rationing, and by that I mean the active denial of effective care as opposed to all the shadow forms of rationing that you're very familiar with that we have already in place today. How can we conceive of doing that? The numbers you saw earlier say very clearly everybody else in the world does a pretty good job, some a little bit better in outcomes, some a little bit worse than ours in certain areas, but everybody spends half or even less than we do on a per capita basis. Is there any way that we can figure out a good way to answer this question? Well, I think actually that there is, and I'm going to lay this out in broad terms and then talk a little bit about each one of them as we go on a little bit further in the morning. If we could get rid of overuse, we would save a lot of money and improve quality immediately. So it's one thing to get control of the dosing in a CT scan when it's delivering a dose of radiation for an appropriate, necessary test. It's a whole other thing to get that dosing right when the image is being done for simple back pain when it's completely unnecessary and leads to harm, proven, demonstrable harm. Getting rid of overuse in that kind of situation is a critically important feature in how we're going to solve this health reform dilemma. And it's not just imaging. It's antibiotics for colds. It's inductions of labor before 39 weeks with no medical indication. Tympanostomy tubes for kids with only a month of effusion. On and on and on. We all know what the examples are. This is the one part of health policy and quality policy that has received no attention, no serious attention in the research community for decades. Lots of reasons behind that. If we don't together, both public stakeholders, patient organizations, as well as physicians, nurses, and hospitals, come to serious grips with this problem, I think we will not be able to avoid the top line there. Now, another quality-driven strategy, which I'll talk more about in a couple minutes, is looking at the incredibly complicated processes that we've created to deliver routine health care, because we've just added on and added on and added on and not looked seriously at what that process was intended to accomplish, what are the necessary value-added parts of that process that have to be done, and what's all the waste that just accumulated like dust in the corner because we weren't paying attention. There's enormous opportunity here, enormous opportunity. If you use some of the tools that I'll talk about a little later, and I know a number of you have experience with, and look, for example, at the wasted effort that your nurses go through, and John talked about this a little bit in terms of workarounds, but take any process, whether it's doing a dressing change or whether it's getting all the stuff you need to do to get together to deliver medications. And if you really seriously and rigorously look at all the steps that individual has to go through, the studies that have been done suggest that 25 or 30% of that time is completely recoverable. It's complete waste. Doesn't contribute, doesn't hurt quality, doesn't improve quality, it's just waste. So if you could increase the number of hours that your nurses spend at the bedside with patients by 25% tomorrow, well, next week. You have to learn some of this stuff first. If you could do that, increase by 25% the worked hours per day per nurse without hiring another nurse, without paying a dollar of overtime, would you do that? Would you think that was an outcome that you might want to invest a little bit in up front? And I'll come back to that in a moment. And then the third is this chronic problem with our inability to really get to the lowest possible level. And I completely agree that aiming for zero for preventable complications is what we have to aim for. And I'm going to talk about some tools that can start us down this road with an accelerated journey. These are the three ways that we could save money, improve quality, or with the second one, at least not impair quality, and we would be able to solve this basic conundrum of how do we pay for effective care for everyone in this country without having to go to these severe restrictions on benefits or payments that I think are inevitable if we fail in this task. So if you then go back with that as sort of the challenge, you go back to this idea of where we would like to end up, which sort of describes a state in which those problems have been solved. And you ask, well, is anybody there? Can I go see what this looks like? I'd really like to visit this place so I could learn and bring this stuff back to my place. Well, the answer in healthcare is no. Sorry. There is no place that is in that state for all their services, all their patients. There are, however, a group of organizations, indeed several industries, and John talked about commercial aviation, which is one of them, that have been studied, and these are called high reliability organizations. The title of my talk, High Reliability, comes from this science, and it is a science, of organizations that deal with extreme hazards, whether it's nuclear power, commercial aviation, wildfire fighting crews. The kinds of organizations that have been studied in this mode are very wide and very broad. What they have in common is they deal with hazard that's every bit as serious as what we deal with in healthcare, only they do it much better than we do, with rates of adverse events that are 1,000, even 10,000-fold lower than in healthcare. And what they have in common, and this is very similar to the themes that John was articulating, I'm going to put it in somewhat different terms. They have two things in common with each other. They have incredibly effective tools to perfect their processes, get all the waste out, get all the defects out. Those two are slightly different. We don't have time to get into a didactic thing about that. Perfect their processes, but that's not enough. What they have that wraps around those improved processes is a fully implemented functioning safety culture that keeps those nearly perfect processes working at very high levels of safety over long periods of time. Sustainability, no degradation, no drifting back to the way it was before because we're not looking at it. That's what they have in common. Carl Weick, who has written a lot about this, one of the authors, if you want a book, Managing the Unexpected is a great one, great start on this stuff, has called safety a dynamic non-event. Now, the non-event part's easy to understand, right? Because bad things don't happen. So safety is the presence of lots of non-events. And parenthetically, if you're into measurement, which I am, by the way, this is one of the reasons we have such a difficult time measuring safety. Because to really measure safety, we would really want to know how many non-events did we prevent today. That's a really difficult measurement challenge. But it's the dynamic word that really starts to give you a flavor of this intersection of nearly perfect processes and a safe culture. Because the way these organizations manage to create this surface, which is very placid, you know, a lake early in the morning, no ripples, nothing going on, under the surface, there is a ton of work that every member of the organization, from the first hired to the most senior, every member of the organization is engaged in. And what they are doing, quite literally, in each in his or her own role, is looking for the smallest indication that something that worked really well yesterday, worked well for months, something's not quite right about it today. Something in the environment, something in the sound of the machine, something in the way the people were going about a task, something's not quite right. And that small clue allows them, when they follow up on it, to prevent processes from breaking down. So they fix their processes before they break, literally, before the explosion that results in catastrophe. That's the secret. Now, if you think about high reliability is up there somewhere and health care today down here somewhere, don't quibble with me. Okay, somebody's a little closer, somebody's a little further away. It's qualitative, not quantitative. How do we get there? The high reliability science tells us a little bit about how organizations that are up there in that cloud actually work and maintain their high reliability, but they don't really tell us how to get from where we are today, which is pretty low reliability. Well, as I indicated earlier, the two things that these organizations have in common, safety culture and process improvement, have led us at the Joint Commission to start thinking about the pathway in these terms. We have to have a fully functional safety culture, and we have to adopt much stronger, better, more durable, more effective process improvement tools. As many of you know at the Joint Commission, we're calling these robust process improvement, and I'll talk a little bit about each of these in a moment, and you'll start to see again some of the themes from John's talk and his work come through. Both of these are necessary. They are not identical, but they come together in what I think is a very powerful way to think about how improvement, safety culture, and high reliability come together. And it is using the three imperatives from a safety culture that were developed by Jim Reason, the same guy who invented the Swiss cheese model. And for my money, the description of what a safe culture really looks like inside a high reliability organization, most applicable to healthcare, comes from Jim's work. Trust, report, and improve. That's all you have to do. John talked about trust. Trust means that every caregiver who works for you at every level, from the entry level in housekeeping and food service, laundry if you have one, every entry level position in the nursing fields, technology, physicians, everybody, everybody trusts each other. They trust each other because in a high reliability organization, to report those small things about equipment maintenance that didn't go quite right, about somebody who had an argument in front of a patient and a family, all of those little things need to be reported. But if there's no trust, if that person is going to get blamed either formally or informally by his or her peers or somebody else in another department coming in and shooting them, you don't get the reports. Now, that's one level of trust. The other level of trust that is critical is they also have to trust not only each other, but they have to trust you. They have to trust management. Because if you get a report through one of these mechanisms and you don't do anything to improve, then that opportunity to grow more trust is lost. And they go back to, why should I tell them anything? Nothing ever changes around here anyway. You need the reports because you can't be just cleaning up after the disasters. That's a very difficult time to fix things. If you get the reports early, you can identify what almost caused harm but didn't and fix that before it causes harm. Communicate that back. It increases trust. You get more reports. It's a very positively reinforcing cycle. Trust, report, and improve. Now, let me spend just a second on the prerequisites for any of this to really take hold and work. The Joint Commission has a leadership chapter in our accreditation manuals, internationally as well as domestically, by the way. And as most of you probably know, the leadership chapter says it's up to the board and then management to create a safe culture. If the board and management are not leading that effort, you can try, but you will not succeed. And so all of the efforts, IHI, as John talked about, and others that are working with boards as we do, is really quite vital. But as you push up to your senior leaders and boards, you can help in this regard too. If quality is not a vital goal, if your board is not talking about it at every meeting, if you don't have dashboards that are transparent to all of your caregivers, it's not first on the agenda no matter what any mission statement says. You have to work, in my view, on all three components of trust, report, improve at once. Each one of them is measurable. You can set objectives, measure progress, and you can get reports and distribute them on the progress that you're making on all of these. They are measurable, you can set objectives, and you can track progress. I'll say that again. They are measurable. You can set goals, and you can track progress. A couple of words about trust, and John touched on this, so I'm not going to spend as much time as I usually do. The aim of a safe culture is not blame-free. There is no high-reliability organization that has a blame-free culture. What high-reliability organizations have is a very clear, very well-understood way to separate the blameless acts that we all make, blameless errors that we all do every day because we're human, separate those for learning. Those should not be dealt with by punishment or discipline, but equally transparently, setting rules for what does constitute a blameworthy act, whether it's behavior, whether it's errors. And those standards have to be the same for everyone. And John touched on that, and you all know very well that we have lots of standards for bad behavior that we tolerate, depending on who the individual is, what professional group or non-professional group they come from. We don't assess errors uniformly. We don't have a single code of behavior for everyone, and that is a problem. Separating the blameless from the blameworthy and having different ways of learning from the blameless acts and dealing appropriately with the blameworthy acts. Why is that important to a safe culture? Well, if caregivers know that there is some group or individuals or a class of folks that can act badly, can make mistakes that everybody else would be punished for, they're not going to trust you to deal with reports that they bring forward. It is a critical part of establishing trust. And, you know, we wrote about this 2 years ago in this Sentinel Event Alert, Behaviors That Undermine a Culture of Safety. Data on this is available at the Institute of Safe Medication Practices Workplace Intimidation Survey. If you haven't seen this, go to their website, look at these data, because the behaviors that we're talking about run a very wide range. Yes, there's physical abuse and there's verbal abuse at the most obvious and egregious end, but at the other end, there's passive behaviors, failure to answer pages, failure to answer questions, condescending tone. That's the stupidest question I ever heard. Did you really graduate from nursing school? And those are the most common, and they are pervasive. In this survey, about a quarter of the more than 2,000 nurses and pharmacists who answered the survey said they had personally experienced those kinds of behaviors from physicians more than 10 times in the past year. And about half that number said had exactly the same experience with those behaviors from non-physicians. Nurses who eat their young, very appropriate description. Now, 2 years later, Time magazine discovered that, yes, rudeness in medicine may hurt more than feelings, and cited our Sentinel Event Alert. They're a little slow, but okay, we'll take the recognition and let's see if we can get more progress on this problem. And the most important part of this message is that the US media, when we started talking about this, and since have misrepresented the issue as disruptive physicians. And yes, it's true that physicians engage in intimidating behavior. I've talked about that already. But this image that the only problem here is the spectacular instrument throwing episodes, and John described one actually, for a different reason, is just so far from the truth and so far from the important message that we really have to focus on the fact that the behaviors that destroy trust and stifle reporting are the much more common ones that are much more difficult to root out. The code of conduct requirement in the Joint Commission Accreditation Standards is really designed to get rid of all of that kind of behavior by putting a structure in place that allows you to come up with standards for it, enforcement mechanisms, and if there is repeated non-compliance, then routing that into an appropriate disciplinary channel. So that's trust. What do we want to report? Well, we want to report adverse events, and that has a whole other history and a whole other set of mechanisms I'm not going to talk about. What we would really like to encourage, though, is the reporting of these other events. Let's call them close calls. And close calls are really important because they are free lessons. They are a series of errors has occurred, a series of defenses has been breached, and somebody makes a save at the last minute. Now, they are critically important, number one, because if you want a very quick test of where your unit or your department or your hospital or your ambulatory surgery center is on this very broad spectrum of the journey to a safe culture, all you have to do for a quick little measurement is ask about close calls. If you are in a situation where there's a lot of punishment going on and everybody's afraid of each other, what you get when you ask about close calls is, huh? What are you talking about? In that kind of environment, nobody will report a close call. If you're in the middle somewhere, this has been termed a bureaucratic culture, and you find out about a close call, you have a very strong temptation to celebrate, right? Because somebody saved the day. Our system is really strong because that patient didn't get hurt. Well, that's not the way high reliability organizations react. The way they react to a close call is exactly the same way as if they had a really serious adverse event, because they know that it's those small lessons that are embedded in what happened to get up to the point where a good catch was necessary that will really tell you about where your systems are weak and where they need to be fixed. So close calls from a reporting standpoint, very, very important. So tying that all together, you've got some trust momentum, you've got some reports. What do you do with them? How do you fix these very troubling problems and these very difficult and resistant system weaknesses? And we've been talking about this at the Joint Commission now since I started in 2008. I did a lot of work at Mount Sinai before I came here on Six Sigma and change acceleration and lean. All of these tools together we are calling robust process improvement because they are much more effective at solving safety and quality problems than anything that has come out of industry before. CQI, TQM, I'm not going to give you a history lesson in those. And the point here is that they are very effective on safety and quality problems. They directly address the failings of a lot of what we try to do in clinical quality improvement. Lack of sustainability, for example. They're appealing to physicians and other clinicians because they are so data-driven. And basically what they are is, together, a very systematic, common-sense approach to solving problems. With a clear definition of what the problem is, developing very accurate, reliable ways to measure the problem, identifying, critically, why the problem is occurring in your organization. I'll come back to this with an example at the end. If you don't understand what the causes of the problem are where you're trying to fix it, you can't target interventions to fix your causes. That's why very often a best practice developed somewhere else doesn't work as well when you try to import it, because it worked on a different set of causes for the very same problem. And all of that Lean and Six Sigma toolkit is very effective at creating better processes, but if you don't deploy it along with formal change management to get the organization ready to accept and implement the change, you won't realize the benefit of it. So that's why we put all of these tools together and call them robust process improvement. Spend one more 30 seconds on sustaining, because it's probably the most difficult challenge for all of us in healthcare. One of the reasons that we have to translate these lessons from high reliability is that we can't use one of the most important mechanisms that they have in perfecting their processes. After they figure out what the best process is to produce no defects and to be as lean as possible, what they often do is automate it from start to finish, right? So when was the last time your bank made a mistake on an ATM transaction? There are no people in there. There's no opportunity for people to make the mistakes that we make every day. We can't do that in healthcare. We depend on people across your organizations to deliver healthcare. So how do we sustain improvement when sustaining that improvement really means changing behaviors and maintaining those changed behaviors? Well, this change management is a critical part of that whole equation. This is a little algebra that's borrowed, stolen actually, from GE. As GE would say, stolen with pride, that expresses this relationship. The effectiveness of any intervention, anything, any intervention, is equal to the technical quality of the solution that you have. So if this protocol would really work to reduce central line infections, that's the technical solution, times the degree to which it is accepted and used by the people that actually have to do those behaviors, times the degree to which you put in accountability and monitoring procedures to know whether they're actually doing it and producing the results that you got when you started. Notice the relationship here is multiplier. The greatest technical solution fails immediately if everybody hates it. The greatest technical solution implemented well fails over time if you fail with the monitoring and accountability. Change management is the two A's, critically important if we're going to get closer to high reliability. And you know, this sounds sort of like a little touchy-feely stuff, this change management, but it has been reduced by a number of companies, including GE, to a set of very specific and very helpful tools, ways of thinking about pieces of the problem, of the two A's, that are really incredibly effective. So here's just one example from this toolkit of change management called resistance analysis. Now, this is one place, when I come to talk about resistance to change, that I don't have to say, well, I know, you know, this is the Midwest, you're all very comfortable with each other, you're very collegial, you don't experience resistance to change, so, you know, but you probably worked somewhere else. There's plenty of resistance to change in New York and in most of the other places that you all are from. So think about how you would go about, and I know you have been working on this problem, improving hand hygiene compliance in your organization. Who would be likely to resist a program to dramatically improve hand hygiene compliance? Not enough to think about just who. It's the why. Why are they resisting? What are the sources of that resistance? And how would you overcome the sources of resistance, depending on what they are? There actually are three completely different kinds of resistance. One is technical resistance. And that, it comes in the form of, you're asking me to do all this new stuff, these new checklists, this new thing. I don't know how to do that. It's training. It's, my stuff is all over the place in different places. I don't know how to do that. That's the simplest one to address, because you say, as part of this intervention, as part of this program, we've developed all of the teaching and all of the training and all of the accompaniments that you're going to need in order to implement this. Don't worry. Come to this session, this workshop. We'll show you how to do it. Political resistance, completely different. Political resistance arises when someone who you need the help and cooperation of is going to lose something because of the solution that your great process improvement team has come up with. Lose could be prestige, control, stature, position, whatever it is. And it's not just the actual, it's the perception of the loss, so it's a little more complicated. And it's further complicated because that kind of resistance is very often expressed as technical resistance. So this tool teaches you how to listen for what's really technical and what's not. If you try a technical resistance solution on somebody who's resisting for political reasons, you'll get nowhere. That requires a completely different approach in order to solve. And third, the cultural resistance component of this equation is, we've never done that before. There's no way that's going to happen here. You want my nurses to stop that doctor from walking in that room if he didn't wash his hands? That'll never happen here. It's not technical, and it's not political. It's cultural, and it needs a different toolkit in order to get over. So these change management tools have to be deployed along with the development of the technical solution if you're going to get to the end of the road with a good technical solution, fully implemented and sustained over time. All three components of RPI. Now, at the Joint Commission, as a number of you already know, we are not just talking about this. We are walking this walk. We are adopting now. Well, we're well into our third year of a very aggressive program of adopting these tools for ourselves and governing all of our process improvement efforts, focusing on our customers. And I hope that most of you, and I hope next year it will be all of you, have seen the difference in the way we do our surveys, the way we do our customer interactions in between surveys. So this is a real thing for us, both with respect to safety culture and RPI. Now, we talked about high reliability and the fact that it doesn't exist anywhere across all services and across all dimensions of care, but here is a model of high reliability that is national. And it's the Joint Commission, the system the Joint Commission created for measuring performance across a small number of measures in hospitals. When this program started 10 years ago, there was huge variability and very low average performance, 50, 60, 40, depending on which measure you look at. But in 2009, for these two measures, for example, the U.S. national average for aspirin on arrival and beta blockers on discharge was 98% across the thousands of hospitals that report to us. Now, the other part of high reliability is consistency. So what's the distribution around that average? Well, one way to answer that question is a simple percentage. What percentage of hospitals were over 90%? Well, that too, remarkably high. So this is almost a picture perfect definition, quantitatively, of high reliability. Very high average performance, no variability around it, and now being maintained over starting to be and what we expect to be a long period of time. And when you think about where we started, as I suggested, the cultural part of this change, this is not just a measurement issue, the cultural part of this change has been extraordinarily rapid. Hospitals resisted the collection of the data, the reporting of the data, using the data to do anything, convincing all of your physicians and nurses, putting procedures in place, which still take a huge amount of effort to maintain this performance, was a very large struggle. But all of this environment has completely changed today, as you know. In a very short time, hospitals have gotten on board with a lot of physician support, not uniform yet. Hopefully that's changing as well, to use these measures to drive changes in clinical practice that mean that millions of patients are getting better outcomes now because these highly evidence-based procedures are being followed much more rigorously. And the Joint Commission, as I hope you've seen in recent days, has taken this program and articulated a framework for moving it into the 21st century. Establishing criteria for measures that truly, when you work to improve on them, result directly in improved outcomes for patients. Those are accountability measures. I'm not going to go through the criteria. About 22 out of the 28 or so measures that are out there now meet those criteria. We should be getting rid of bad measures to replace them with good ones, increase the clinical credibility of this program, and make it drive even more toward improved health. Another index of how much of a success story this is if you look across all these accountability measures, and there were very few in the beginning, more in the middle, and more toward the end, if you look at the performance, again, across all hospitals, across all accountability measures, including the SCIP measures and all the other ones, in the beginning, the percentage of hospitals over 90% was very low. It was about 20%. Then something remarkable happened. All of your organizations and your colleagues across the country started to figure out how to do this well. And the improvement has been staggering. 86% of hospitals over 90% on accountability measures in 2009 and rising. The future here, very fortunately, is now. These are largely the measures that will be available to the secretary when she decides which ones she's going to pluck out of that basket and make the targets for value-based purchasing and incentive payments in 2013. We've articulated, starting 2 months ago with the publication of this paper and our new policy on accountability measures, we have launched a series of new initiatives to help hospitals get there even faster, eliminate the bad measures. And as we do that, we should be very happy to be held accountable to the good measures, the ones that really improve outcomes for patients. So we have started to have a big, major, ongoing dialogue with all of your organizations about how exactly we build into accreditation requirements performance expectations, not just the requirement to report. Medicare is going to change that in 2013 to a payment incentive. We think we're almost there so that accountability measures can really be where hospitals shine with respect to high reliability. And that includes performance expectations built into accreditation standards. All the details are going to be worked out with great input from the field. We will include, going forward, only accountability measures in ORICS and all of the other measurement-related programs, and we will be rolling out a number of initiatives, including the ability of hospitals to share with each other through a secure exchange, a web-based exchange, what interventions you all developed that were important in helping you get over a particular barrier with a particular measure, recognition programs, and a variety of other programs, all designed to achieve the same goal: new direction for performance measurement. And as I said, we're in the middle of adopting RPI for ourselves, but not only for ourselves. We're in now the second full year of the operation of a program that has gotten together now 19 hospitals that have mastered these tools of RPI to focus them on specific, nasty safety and quality problems, to use the tools to develop new interventions that work, and that our job as the Joint Commission is to spread this learning to hospitals of every size, of every description, recognizing that most of your organizations and your colleagues will not have Six Sigma or Lean expertise. It won't be necessary to benefit from these tools and their output. This part of the Joint Commission is the newest part, called the Center for Transforming Healthcare. It is separate from accreditation. And you can get to this website right from the Joint Commission's website, and I would encourage you to look around on it. Several forward-looking companies, including Medline, have chosen to support the work of this center, and that is a critical part of our overall strategy, which I'll mention in a second. And Medline actually set the world's land speed record from first contact to recognition of how aligned this center was with, as Jim said, Medline's objective to become an outcome improvement company, to establishing the relationship, which was, I think, under 7 weeks, which was an extraordinary tribute. I think it will be hard to break that record. Sue, Jim, thank you. I believe that this activity on the part of the Joint Commission responds directly to what I have been hearing our customers saying very loud and clear, and certainly what I felt when I was on the other side just 3 years ago at Mount Sinai. Okay, Joint Commission, you know, medication reconciliation, wrong site surgery, handoff communication, all we get it. Those are really important problems. But stop telling us only about the problems and start telling us how to fix them. How do we fix them so they stay fixed? As I said, we're raising outside funding support at probably the worst time in like 100 years to raise money for something that's brand new in particular. But we have been modestly successful. The Joint Commission put in the first $10 million. We have seven major donors now. GSK was the last, most recent to come on board, each at $1 million or more. And the idea here is to raise outside funding support so that we could deliver the results of the center's work to accredited organizations as part of accreditation, so that the cost, if we had to recoup all the research and development costs that we're putting into this by charging you all for using them, that cost would be a barrier to use, and we don't want that to happen to the extent that is possible. So that is still our goal. In 2009, we launched three projects: hand hygiene, wrong site surgery, handoff communication. We will finish the first two of those in 2010. We're launching a project together with the American College of Surgeons on Wednesday of this week, using their NISQIP data to reduce surgical site infection following colorectal surgery. The center was announced publicly in September. You can see that public launch on the website. These are the participating hospitals and systems, as I mentioned, selected because they were already masters of Lean and Six Sigma and change acceleration so that we can do these projects on business timeframes. And I said that the first project that we picked was hand hygiene. The reason we picked it is we asked these organizations which of all the safety and quality problems you're struggling with is the most important one for you to solve for your own organization. The number one problem that got the most number one votes, hand hygiene. Now, if you remember the sort of the equation of E equals Q times A, this is not a data problem. I mean, we know what the solution is. You wash your hands. The data are very clear. This is data from one hospital associated infection death rates in one department from month to month. A hand washing program is put in place at this moment in time. The death rates plummeted. We don't really need all the fancy statistics to know that this is incredibly significant. Now, unfortunately, these data are from the 1840s. They are actually Ignaz Semmelweis's original data from the maternity hospital in Vienna, where he demonstrated that it's really a good idea to wash your hands before you deliver babies. So to illustrate this principle that I said at the beginning is the heart of RPI, understanding what the causes of the failures are. So these are five of about 25 of the major causes of failure to clean hands. In this group of eight hospitals, about half the hospitals did this project last year. Most of them thought they were doing really well, and they weren't. They were misled by bad data. There was still a problem with dispenser location that you're all familiar with. Number three surprised them, though. A nurse would come up to a patient's room where hands were full of stuff to do a dressing change, and there was no place to put it down. So she missed the opportunity to wash her hands. Ineffective education. The patient safety culture comes in the last one, where there were significant safety culture problems, and nobody was calling individuals on blowing by opportunities to wash hands, the rates were even lower. Now, notice one thing about just these five, and that's like I said, there are 15 or 20 more. Each one of those causes requires a very different strategy, a very different intervention in order to fix. And if you look on the center's website, you'll see this teased out cause by cause, causes on the left, solutions on the right. Each of these hospitals developed specific interventions and proved them on the causes that were most important to them. And the punchline here is, also on the center's website, the causes differed from one hospital to another, markedly in many instances. That's why the best practice one size fits all very often fails for complex problems. And hand hygiene, as you well know, even though the public doesn't see it this way, is an incredibly complicated problem. The hospitals are A, B, C, D. The first top 10 causes are the rows. The X's represent where a cause was prevalent in a hospital. So if hospital A designed a very effective package of interventions to solve its problem, hospital F would not benefit very much. And other examples. So this is where the center hospitals who started on this project thought they were, 80 to 90% performance, including Hopkins and Cedars and Memorial Hermann and all the others. And when they measured accurately, they found that they were actually starting out at 48%. With huge variability, those bouncing around dots there are the compliance, hand hygiene compliance, on just one unit from day to day. The hallmark of low reliability, really low average performance and lots of variability. And over time, in that year that's passed, the hospitals have gotten up over 80%, maintained it consistently, and with the help of some technology, we believe that they'll get even higher. And even more, or perhaps equally gratifying, because even though the evidence that hand hygiene is really important in preventing the spread of infection, the skeptics always say, what happened to the infection rates in these hospitals? And we're starting to get those data. This is from one hospital which showed hospital-wide the decline of about two-thirds in their HAIs as hand hygiene got closer and closer to 100% up on the horizontal axis there. And these data will keep rolling in to the center. So how do we spread this? This is a very nice little science project at a few hospitals. And we recognize that in order to get the maximum impact, we need to be able to get this information to every kind of hospital of varying sizes and capabilities. We are producing those tools that will allow all of your organizations, small, medium, or large, to measure accurately, figure out what your causes are, match those causes to interventions proven in the center's database to work, and we are engaging industries like Medline in helping provide the rest of the solution set to keep these things going over long periods of time. Now, I said specifically that we are aiming toward benefiting accredited organizations with this information at no added cost as long as possible. That keeps the number of projects that we can run down, unfortunately, but hopefully that will change soon. One of the ways we are doing this is by training our surveyors in how to give you help in accessing these tools. They already communicate the traditional best practices, and I know that they have been better at that in the last couple of years than they have been, and we will keep encouraging that and rewarding that. But we are also creating web-based tools that you will be able to get access through our extranet connection with you, but this will be completely separate from accreditation, that will guide you through all of the steps in this process. These tools are put together to allow each organization, you can do it unit by unit, you can do it for the whole house, however you like, to measure accurately, figure out what the causes of hand hygiene failure are in the place you're trying to fix it, see a roster of interventions proven to work on those causes, choose from them, implement them, and then bring the results back to this suite of web tools that we're calling TST. We have to have acronyms. Targeted Solutions Tool. It will debut next month, and you will have access to it hopefully by the end of September. And I encourage you to look for the announcements about when that will be previewed so you can get familiar with it. This will be the platform through which all of the solutions developed by the center will be delivered directly to accredited organizations at no added cost. Now, JCR will also be amplifying the impact through its publications, educational offerings, and consultations, and that will continue. We'll continue to put lots of this stuff on the center's website, publish about it, et cetera. The 2010 priorities include completing these first two projects, hand hygiene and wrong site surgery. What we do after the developmental work with a group of the center hospitals who use all these Lean Six Sigma change acceleration tools is pilot that in a group of other hospitals that are completely unfamiliar in varying levels. So in the hand hygiene results, for example, from 8, we went to 26 other pilot hospitals and found very similar findings, packaged that in ways that translated all the jargon out, et cetera, made sure they worked, and then prepare them for launch in TST. The wrong site surgery project is being now piloted both in hospitals and in ambulatory surgery facilities, and we hope that will be available in the TST probably early next year. We're expanding to 25 participating hospitals. As I said, Wednesday, together with the new leader of the American College of Surgeons, Dave Hoyt, who's incredibly enthusiastic about this approach to quality improvement, we are launching that with a group of 7 center hospitals, and we will be using the NISQIP outcome measures, the risk-adjusted outcome measures that come out of NISQIP, which are wonderfully clinically derived as opposed to the billing data, which Medicare uses to produce its outcome data. And the marriage of the NISQIP outcome data with this approach to systematically solving problems and finding out why, in this case, there's so much variability around outcomes, surgical site infection following colorectal surgery, is a perfect way to marry the two expertises. That will you'll be hearing reports on that throughout the year. By the end of this year, we are looking with our center hospital group to create a project around reducing preventable hospitalizations. And we're expanding beyond hospitals and internationally as the center grows. There's a tremendous demand for this worldwide. I think we are uniquely positioned to have a maximum impact using these tools. The reach of the Joint Commission to 18,000 now accredited organizations, the production of real and practical safety and quality solutions. We hope that we can accelerate and secondarily spread this knowledge, which has been very difficult to do over time in terms of in terms of sustainability and spread. And then over time, as we figure out what the critical interventions are that work everywhere, that loop gets connected back, just like it has now with performance measurement, to accreditation standards, so that everyone will need to follow those new best practices and those new standards for standard work. And this really, I'll leave you with this challenge, which I've done for a lot of groups around the country. Can we transform healthcare into a high reliability industry with rates that are, this says, comparable to? We should be better than airlines. We should be better than nuclear power. Can we do that? I don't think we have any choice. And I look forward to working with you, your colleagues across the country, to making that vision a reality. Thank you very much.